Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to First Presbyterian Church. Welcome to our 10:30 service here in the sanctuary. We also want to welcome those who are joining us online on Facebook Live and other ways. We hope that you have a wonderful experience with us today as we lift up Jesus, we study his word, and we try to encourage God's people. Let me review a few items of COVID-19 safety protocol, and there are some new items on this list that I need you to help me with today. As always, we're encouraging 6-foot social distancing between households while seated here in the sanctuary. You'll probably notice when you came in, we have some new signs that are posted here and there to help remind us of that and to spread us out into a strategic way. I still promise you there are plenty of seats to go around. But if you would just take note of those signs and try to spread out between households between those different areas, that would be much appreciated. As you know, there is an increase right now in Highland County with coronavirus. And as a church, we're just trying to do everything we know how to do to keep everyone safe and healthy. So thanks again for your help. Hand sanitizer remains available in the back. Disinfecting wipes remain available in our restrooms. We would ask that while you're here in the service, that if you're able, please wear a mask. We do have free masks available in the back. And also, a new item this week, in an effort to keep our office staff safe, the church office this week and until further notice is closed to on-site walk-in visitors. However, that doesn't mean that Sarah is not at work. It doesn't mean I'm not on call. You can still receive assistance from the church office by calling 981-3735, that's the office number, or by emailing greenfieldfirstpresbyterian@gmail.com. I'm available. I'm still happy to meet with you as needed. You can reach me at 937-876-9868 or email me at pastormikeanderson77@gmail.com. I'm also available on Facebook. So again, the COVID-19 safety protocol is something we're really trying to do, not to be an encumbrance, not to mess up your day, but to keep you safe. We think about this a lot. I think about this a lot. The Board of Session has thought and prayed about this and planned for this a lot. And so, again, just help us with that in every way possible. One of the ways that we worship God is by giving of our tithes and offerings to him. There are 3 ways that you can do that. You can put your gift in the offering plate in the back of the sanctuary. You can text the word give to 937-249-6665. Or you can mail your gift to the church address, which is 457 Jefferson Street, Greenfield, Ohio, 45123. Nursery and junior church are now back open. And we are using lots of COVID-19 safety protocol to keep our youngsters and our volunteers safe. We have adjusted our schedule so that Family Worship Sunday is now the first Sunday of the month, so that on Communion Sunday, all members of families can sit together and partake of communion together. We thought that was a good thing. Next Sunday is the deadline to return your boxes for our Costa Rica box project. You can fill these boxes with gifts and with school supplies. You can follow the guidelines inside the box. We had 40 boxes go out to members of our church. Follow the list on the inside of what to give and what not to give. Make sure you fill out the inventory sheet so that the Costa Rican Customs Department has that as they process the box coming into the country. And please include $10, either $10 cash or a $10 check in the box to cover shipping. Checks can be made out to First Presbyterian Church. Next Sunday, October 25th, is the day that we'll bring all the boxes back. We're going to have a special time of prayer as we prepare to ship those boxes to Costa Rica the following week. We will be filling blessings in a bag this Thursday, October 22nd at 6:30 right here at the church, and volunteers are welcome. We will be following COVID-19 safety protocol while doing that, which includes, of course, the social distancing and the wearing of masks. But you're welcome to come and help us with blessings in a bag. We will be serving close to 250 children this year. There's 150 children at Greenfield Elementary, and we're estimating right now up to 100 children at Buckskin Elementary. Buckskin is new on our list of children to serve. That comes to 250 each time we do blessings in a bag. We're doing that twice a month and the last 2 weekends of the month. And so we need your help to fill those bags, and that's this Thursday at 6:30. Next Sunday is a fall hayride. The deacons are sponsoring. It's going to take place at Kyle and Valerie Williams' house at 4 p.m. next Sunday, the 25th. Their address is 13181 Collier Road. Food and drinks and paper products will be provided by our deacons committee, but we're asking you to bring a lawn chair, and we're reminding you that, as always, COVID-19 safety protocol will be followed. And when you ride on the hayride, as we'll be seated a little closer together, we do require that masks be worn while on the hayride itself. Last announcement. There's going to be a congregational meeting on Sunday, November 15th. This is an annual meeting, and the purpose of it is to elect our church officers for the coming year and to approve the church budget for 2021. Everybody's welcome to attend. Church members, you have an opportunity to vote for all those items that day. That's Sunday, November 15th, about 30 days from now. We're going to prepare our hearts for worship this morning with our morning prelude with an old classic hymn called "O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing," as we also observe the ministry of our acolytes as they bring in the light of Christ into our midst. Let's prepare our hearts.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. I will praise the name of God with song, and will magnify him with thanksgiving. Please stand and join our worship team in singing, "I've Got the Joy, 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 Joy Down in My Heart."
We're going to need your best big, bold "where" and "ouch" at some point in time, if you know this, old children's classic. So join with us if you will this morning.
The day.
Thank you, David. Thank you all for being here with us this morning. When I was a kid, I learned a verse of that song that you got to get your lips all loosened up. It says, I've got the wonderful love of my blessed Redeemer way down in the depths of my heart. But we thought you might drool on yourself if we did that verse, so we didn't do that one this morning. Thank you for being here this morning. One of the ways that we can encourage one another is by sharing our joys and our concerns together. Maybe you have a prayer request or a praise that you'd like to express. Here in the sanctuary, we have a microphone in the center aisle where you can step up to that mic and share with us whatever you have on your heart. For those of you who are watching at home on the internet, you can text in your request or email in your request or message it right on the live stream itself and share with us your request. So what needs do you have? What joys or concerns do you have today?
So I pray for my brother Tim and his wife Cindy. They both have got COVID and they've got hit pretty hard with it.
So remember Tim and his wife in prayer.
I would like for us to hold Reverend Harold Turner in our hearts. He is a dear pastor from our church camp, and he is elderly, quite elderly, and had a bad fall and has broken his hip. Not good news, but we will pray that he'll be better, right?
Absolutely. Let's lift him up in prayer. Thank you for that.
I'd like prayers for Gary Great. He has COVID, but he's doing better, so that's a joy. But also our cafeteria is very short-staffed, so we're down to four women working. But we're grateful to have principals that are assisting us and even Quincy, so the school system has really pulled together for that.
Remember Gary in prayer, and his wife Donna, and all the school staff and the students that are impacted from all that's going on. Any other joys or concerns this morning? I want to praise the Lord for the wonderful hike that our church family experienced yesterday together out at the woods in the Highlands Nature Sanctuary at Barrett Rim Trail. There was about a dozen of us who took a little adventure together, and we had a wonderful morning, great fellowship, and some beautiful scenery. So I'm thankful to God for that opportunity. Any other prayer requests or praises this morning before we pray? Let's bow our heads together. Loving God, we thank you that you are on the throne. And you are on the throne even when the world around us seems out of control. And we acknowledge your sovereignty. We acknowledge your control. We acknowledge your power this morning. And those truths bring us peace and hope and strength in difficult days. We pray for many people who are struggling with COVID-19. Many people around us, people that we know. It feels, Father, that this is coming closer and closer to home. And there's more folks that we're acquainted with that are being impacted. So be with our community. Be with our school system. I know there are a lot of staff members that are out due to this virus, due to the quarantine orders. Lord, we pray that you'd give our school strength and endurance and wisdom for the days ahead. And just keep us safe. We pray for those who are needing a special touch from you. We think of the request of the gentleman who broke a hip. We pray for him this morning. We pray you touch his body in a special way. You know the needs of our hearts. You know the deepest secrets of our hearts, Lord. So we just ask you to examine us today and cleanse our hearts and make us right with you. We thank you for the grace of Jesus. We thank you for his cross and for his resurrection. That he has offered us through his grace the gift of salvation and forgiveness of sin. We give you praise and we ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This time, boys and girls can be dismissed to junior church. The rest of the congregation, we invite you to stand with us if you're able and sing a great hymn, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us.
The scripture reading this morning is from Galatians 5, 16 through 23. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want, but you are led by the Spirit. You are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, self-ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sarah. Today we continue to ask ourselves the question, what is a disciple of Jesus Christ? What are the character qualities that should be seen in the life of a person who names the name of Jesus and claims to be his child? Well, that's the purpose of this teaching series, to examine those truths and try to paint a clear picture of the blueprint of how does the New Testament describe a follower of Jesus or a disciple. The mechanism that we use to paint this picture during this series is threefold: heart, head, and hands. We're looking at the character of a disciple, we're looking at the knowledge of the disciple, and we're looking at the mission of the disciple, our being, our knowing, and our doing. And this is the broad picture of how we're trying to paint this for you in description. We've been talking for the past three Sundays about the qualities of the heart, the character deep down inside of us, of those of us who say that we're followers of Jesus. The broad strokes of the characters of the heart include three things. Number one, a gospel-centered identity, that is who I am in Jesus Christ. Second, being connected to God with prayer and the word or the scriptures or other spiritual practices that help us know him more intimately. And third, today we'll look at the fruit of the Spirit that impacts and guides our character. So today we want to look into that passage that Sarah read for us, Galatians chapter 5, as we talk about living the fruit of the Spirit. We looked at the text, you saw it as was written and was read to us this morning, and in that text you'll notice that there were two lists that described character qualities. One list, the first one, seemed remarkably bad. As you read that first list, it maybe kind of describes a frat party at college. You're thinking, is this a description of what happened on Friday night at the university? Or the second list talks about character qualities that are produced in us through the Holy Spirit's lordship in our life. What I want to say to you as we set this up this morning is root determines fruit. What we're not proposing this morning is we just all try a lot harder and work a lot harder and try to produce character qualities in ourselves through our own energies on our own. What we're saying to you this morning, rather, is that we need to understand where our souls are rooted. Root determines fruit. You understand that in the physical world, that the root system is the mechanism by which the source of nutrients is absorbed and is distributed to the entire plant in order to sustain life and to produce its fruit. The roots, though they may not be seen very clearly, are vitally important for the health of the plant. And if the root system is diseased or if it's damaged, of course, the health of the entire plant is in jeopardy, and it could in fact wither and die. And so the question we want to ask ourselves today is, where are we rooted? Again, the two lists in the Bible. The first list, the acts of the sinful nature. Some of our Bible translations, the one we read from this morning is the NIV. It talks about the works of the flesh. Others call it the acts of the sinful nature. And you can see this big long laundry list. This is the list you're thinking, boy, if that describes me, I've certainly got some work to do in my life. And this is the picture that Paul is painting. He says, if your life is rooted alone in your sinful nature, according to if you're just drifting naturally according to human nature, this is the natural tendency of our lives. This list right here. Now that's not a pretty list. Now that's not to say everybody who lives apart from the Holy Spirit's control in their life exhibits every single one of those things. That's not actually the point of Paul. What he's saying is this is the natural, human, fleshly, sinful nature direction that our lives will tend generally to take apart from the Spirit's control. Is your life rooted in the sinful nature or in the Holy Spirit? The second list, I'm glad that second list is in the text, by the way. It'd be a really depressing message if it ended with the first list. But the second list is the opposite. These are character qualities that are not produced on our own, not produced just by trying harder and pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps, but these are produced by being rooted and grounded in a real, authentic relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, and His Holy Spirit is leading us and guiding us in our lives. And if we live under the Holy Spirit's leadership, then this list describes the natural tendency or the natural direction through the Holy Spirit of our lives. What a stark contrast between the two lists, right? And so I ask you this morning to think about this with me. I like what the Living Bible says in that 22nd verse. The Living Bible is an English paraphrase that was written a number of years ago. But listen to how it words verse 22. But when the Holy Spirit controls our lives, He will produce this kind of fruit in us. This morning's message is not a self-help message. This morning's message is about making God the Lord of our life, yielding to His Holy Spirit, and as a result of that relationship with God, this fruit is the natural result. I didn't say it all happened overnight, but this is the direction our lives will take if we are under the Holy Spirit's control. So let me ask you, what is the root of your life? What is the root of your life this morning? Are you rooted in your sinful nature and that's the path that your life is taking? Or are you under the Holy Spirit's direction and guidance and lordship? What's the root of your life? And sometimes that's hard to discern. There are days I feel like I've got one foot in this side, another foot on the other side, and I'm on the fence. Or there are days I'm clear over here. There might be other days I'm on the other side of the fence. But I wonder, what's the root of our life and what's the fruit of our life? In other words, which of these lists is showing up more for you? Is the fruit of your life the works of the flesh, list number one, that scary list? Or is it the second list, the fruit of the Spirit? Which list paints the picture of who you are more? All of these questions, when I ask and preach like this, I have to tell you that I'm preaching to myself. You folks get to gather and listen into the message that is for me. And so if God happens to apply these things to your life, just know that He's been applying them to mine as well. What's the fruit of your life? I'm going to show you a picture that helps us understand the issue of the fruit of the Spirit and how it kind of shows up in our lives. There's four areas. This diagram or this illustration is taken from Dana Allen's book called Simple Discipleship. And I really appreciated this picture because it helps me understand more of how God applies the truth of the fruit of the Spirit to us. There's four broad areas of living that when we live the fruit of the Spirit, four broad areas of living that it seems to impact us. One is sacrificial living. One is gracious living. One is satisfied living. One is devoted living. Sacrificial living will seem to indicate something of the fruit of love and generosity. By the way, the fruit of generosity is also called goodness in some of the Bible translations. Gracious living is connected to gentleness and kindness. Satisfied living connected to peace, patience, and joy. And devoted living, finally, is faithfulness and self-control. We're going to look at all those briefly this morning. So again, four broad areas. I want to ask you to look inside your heart today and ask yourself, am I experiencing growth in these four areas in my life? Is God doing a work in me through the power of His Holy Spirit in these areas of my life? And what does that look like for me? He's going to produce these in us. Let's take the first one. Let's look at sacrificial living to start with. Sacrificial living means that we exhibit the sacrificial nature of Jesus toward others. Let's not rush past that sentence. The sacrificial nature of Jesus? Do you remember what the sacrificial nature of Jesus entailed? He went to the cross. He gave His own life. He bore the burden of sin so that you and I could go free. He gave everything so that you and I could know Him. Sacrificial living means we exhibit the sacrificial nature of Jesus toward others. And it doesn't come from simply trying harder, but it comes from being overwhelmed by this nature of who Jesus is. Are you overwhelmed by His grace and goodness to you? Are you overwhelmed by His love for you? By His sacrifice for you? He calls us to live in a very similar way. It involves giving up valuable resources. Oh, this bothers the Western American church in our time of being sacrificial. We like to put ourselves first. But if we're going to follow Jesus, and if His Holy Spirit is going to lead our lives, if we're truly being sacrificial, we're going to do these kind of things even for people who are not able to repay us or to help advance our own personal agendas. It's sacrificial living, not selfish living. Very different. Very, very different. And so connected to this idea of sacrificial living are the fruits of love and generosity. And again, generosity is called goodness in some of your Bibles in front of you. Love and generosity. Did you know that true biblical love is a choice, not an emotion? Our society kind of makes love out to be this warm, fuzzy emotion that we feel. And certainly feelings are impacted by true love. But love is more than a feeling, it's a choice. It's deliberately expressing itself in loving ways and always seeking the welfare of others. That's the choice that we make when we choose to love someone. The biblical word for love is agape. And agape is that selfless love, that love that sent Jesus to the cross, that unconditional love. And so this biblical love that we're seeing in the fruit of the Spirit sets aside one's own preferences, one's own desires, and even one's own needs, and puts the other person first. I ask me, is the fruit of love seen in my life? And if you're like me, you think, boy, it's getting hot in here, isn't it? This is an uncomfortable conversation. I'm not sure I'm doing that great with the fruit of love. Let's look at the next one, biblical generosity. It's about showing readiness to give above and beyond what is common. Generosity, also called goodness in some Bibles. Paul wrote a lot of times to different churches in the New Testament, the church at Philippi, the church at Corinth, the church at Thessalonica, the church at Rome, and so forth. And there were many times where Paul would commend the church for giving of their resources to help people that were from a faraway place. And he credited them, and he praised the people when they would give generously. And this is more than just a financial conversation, by the way. Biblical generosity does impact what we do with our money, but it's far broader than that. See, being generous can involve the plentiful sharing of our money, our possessions, our time, our talents, our knowledge, our experiences, and you can just go ahead and keep adding to the list those things which you need to be investing in the lives of others. This is the fruit of generosity as we see in Scripture. Money's involved, but it's not only limited to money. Let's look next not only at sacrificial giving, but at gracious living. Gracious living. This involves exhibiting care, humility, and compassion when interacting with others. This needs to be one of the hallmark traits of a Christian person, by the way. Gentleness and kindness are the two fruit of the Spirit that are connected to this part of our Christian life. And so gentleness is not weakness. Underline that in your mind, would you? Gentleness is not weakness, but it instead is strength under control. At the 8:30 service, I shared with them the illustration that of our nation. Our nation, the United States of America, is arguably the strongest and most well-developed military power on the face of the planet. But with great resource comes great responsibility. This is not a political statement. I hate election year, for the record. But strength under control should be one of the hallmark traits of who we are as a nation. Oh, make no mistake about it, we need to use our military. The United States has in its history done so. But it's been very selective about when it does that. And so gentleness, this fruit of gentleness is not weakness, but it's strength under control. And as a Christian, this needs to be part of what defines who we are and how we live. It's the opposite of self-assertiveness. It's the opposite of self-interest. And it's a key ingredient in the unity and in the peace which the body of Christ needs to experience. In other words, if we, the Christian people of the church, do not live according to the fruit of gentleness, we're always going to be putting ourselves first and shoving our way to the front of the line and always mad at everybody else. And too often, that has been the case in many a church in America and beyond. The fruit of gentleness would go a long way to remedying that problem. Kindness is fairly closely connected to it. Kindness is the quality of not only possessing moral goodness and integrity, but also expressing it in the way you act towards others. Kindness is not just something you feel on the inside, it's something you do on the outside, you see. I love Mark Twain. I love anything Mark Twain, but listen to this Mark Twain quote. This kind of hits the nail on the head. Kindness is the language which the deaf can hear and the blind can see. Chew on that quote all afternoon long and ask yourself, is the fruit of kindness showing up in my life? Let's look thirdly at satisfied living on this list of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5. Satisfied living. This is about living a joyful, non-anxious life in the midst of all circumstances. I hate that sentence. Does anybody else? A joyful, non-anxious life in the midst of all circumstances. You are looking at the guy who lays awake at night. My body is tired, but my brain says, oh no, let's plan the next 20 years of your life all tonight. Am I the only one that struggles? Okay. Confession is good for the soul. A joyful, non-anxious life, regardless of the circumstances, and even in the midst of extreme hardship, the idea of satisfied living would say that we can maintain a positive attitude by the Spirit's work in us. When things don't go my way, when I'm living under my flesh, when I'm living according to my normal human nature, I like to complain about it. I may tell you how I feel about that bad situation that does not make me happy. I've been known to do that on not so rare occasions. But if I'm living under the Spirit's control with this idea of satisfied living, I can understand that God is still sovereign and God is still in control, and I can still have peace and I can still have joy, and I can lay my burdens at His feet because I know that He's in control of all things. That's two very different scenarios. Do you see the tension that we live in constantly? I generally live over here going, I'm going to lay in bed, don't worry about it, because you know that'll fix everything, right? But rather, I need to be under the Spirit's control and just let him handle it. I'm not good at letting Him handle it. I kind of like to handle it my way, and that's where the anxious thing comes in. Am I talking to a wall this morning? Is anybody else in my boat? Well, while living a satisfied life, it's not easy. It is something we can learn, and it is something that the Spirit wants to develop in us. If you have your Bible, look quickly at Philippians 4:12. Now, we love to quote Philippians 4:13. That's the one that says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Someone said, that's a verse, I can do all things through Christ, of a verse we often take out of context, right? But let me give you the context of the verse. Verse 12, Philippians 4:12. Paul says this, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, or whether living in want. And then he says, verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. What is the all things that Paul can do? It's being satisfied in life, trusting in God, regardless of whether it's good or whether it's bad, whether our circumstances are what we wanted or whether our circumstances have greatly disappointed us. Paul says, I can do all things. I can deal with both of those times through Christ who gives me strength. Now, there's the context. That's even a better life verse to have now if you know the context. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Satisfied living is not easy, but the Holy Spirit desires to produce it in you and me. And so the fruit that's connected to this category is peace, patience, and joy. Now, you're going to have to be patient with me this morning because I'm probably the least patient person in the room today. Peace, patience, and joy is the fruit that the Spirit wants to produce in this category of satisfied living. Peace is experiencing a tranquil or calm state of being no matter the circumstances of life. A tranquil or calm state of being no matter the circumstances of life. When things go wrong in your life, how do you respond? I'm glad there's not a camera on me every day filming how I respond when things don't go well. Peace. Do you have peace? The song that we sing, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. And if you know the story behind that hymn, Horatio Spafford lost his four daughters in a tragic accident on the Atlantic Ocean on an ocean-lining vessel. They'd perished along with hundreds of others. And as he sailed to be with his grieving wife, he wrote the words to that song, It Is Well With My Soul. Do you have peace, regardless of the circumstances? Joy, it's experiencing gladness and delight in God that is not diminished by our circumstances. Now, joy and happiness are not the same. Let's be clear. I don't confuse them today. Happiness is often dependent on the stuff that's happening around us. Whether I got stuck in traffic, whether my spouse was happy this morning, whether the dog bit me in the ankle or not before I went to work. Happiness is rooted in our circumstances, but joy is not diminished by our circumstances if it's rooted in God. Are you joyful even when things aren't going right? Is there a joy that knowing that God is still there no matter what's happening? Patience. Oh, I hate this one the worst. Patience is exhibiting endurance, long-suffering, and perseverance, regardless of the circumstances around us. You keep hearing that last phrase, don't you? regardless of the circumstances around us. Patience. Yeah, God needs to do a work in me on that one. Patience. I'm quick to speak. I'm quick to tell you what's wrong. I'm quick to correct the problem. I'm quick to just do most anything. But patience is one of those areas that God's Spirit needs to continually work on me. And I might not be alone. Is the fruit of patience showing up in you? Or is the natural tendency of our life to live under the works of the flesh, just our natural human nature, we just kind of let it drift that way? And the opposite of patience is impatience, which leads to frustration, which leads to fighting, which leads to anger, which leads to lots of other things. And that's the natural direction our life will take apart from the Spirit's control. But if we're willing to submit ourselves to the Spirit's leadership, patience is one of those unusual characteristics these days that will begin to show up in our life. Root determines fruit. One more, devoted living. We're almost there. Devoted living. This involves remaining faithful to our commitments to God, to others, and to ourselves, especially in the midst of different temptations. Remaining faithful. Faithfulness and self-control are the two fruit that are connected to this particular area. Faithfulness, self-control. Faithfulness is to be reliable or trustworthy in our words. Can I park there for just a moment? Some of you probably remember the day when a person said something and they shook your hand and you agreed on it. It was as good as anything. It was as complete and factual as could be. Their word was good. But anymore, it seems that that has shifted in our world. But the fruit of faithfulness says that we are trustworthy in our words. We're trustworthy in our attitudes and in our actions too. We are dependable and we keep our commitments. Oh, would to God the Church of Jesus Christ would be known for that. We do what we say and we say what we do. It's the fruit of faithfulness in our life. It's only produced by yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit. This is not something you can conjure up on your own, at least not in a consistent way. Self-control is near to it. This is the purposeful act of yielding to God's Spirit in order to say no to the temptation and sinful desires that come our way. In other words, you have to say yes to God and say no to the bad stuff. You got to say yes to the Holy Spirit's leadership before you can say no to those works of the flesh or the acts of the sinful nature. The Apostle James really actually repeats the same principle in his letter later in the New Testament, the book of James. He says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. In other words, you got to say yes to God, then you say no to the stuff that's wrong, and that will produce the results in your life that God desires for you. And it's in that order. And so the fruit of self-control acknowledges that we have said yes to the Holy Spirit's leadership in us, and we have said no through his direction and his guidance to those things in our life that would be displeasing to God. You'll see a graphic on the screen in this picture of Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, but frankly, the prettier picture is here on the stained glass window on the south side of the sanctuary. Jesus praying in the garden. I wonder, will you pray the prayer that he prayed there? I dare you. Not my will, but thine be done. Will you say yes to God, no to yourself, no to the sinful desires around you, and allow the Holy Spirit to be in charge of your life? Jesus knew what was coming. He knew the pain and the hardship and the death, the agony physically that was coming his way in just hours from this prayer time in the Garden of Gethsemane. But more than that, he knew God was about to turn his back and his blessing away from Jesus. He was about to bear the sins of the world, and he was going to proclaim on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? And yet he prayed, not my will, but thine be done. Jesus clearly knew what was at stake. But he was willing to do what God wanted instead of what he wanted. He says, if it's possible, God, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Will you pray that prayer for your life? Well, you're not facing the cross, not the same kind of cross. But we do need to die daily to self and submit daily, hourly, moment by moment to the Holy Spirit in us. So again, there's two lists in Galatians 5. There's the acts of the sinful nature, sometimes called the works of the flesh. Looks like a frat party gone wrong. Or there's the second list, the fruit of the Spirit. Both of these lists are the natural result of submitting to that thing which has the greatest control in your life. Is it your sinful nature? Or is it the work of the Holy Spirit? Root determines fruit. So are you ready for the closing uncomfortable questions? This is the part where I sweat. The closing uncomfortable questions. Which list best describes your character? The works of the flesh or the fruit of the Spirit? If you were to ask your friends, which list best describes your character? Which one would they go with? Let's turn it up a notch. Which list best describes your life when no one is watching? Yeah, I told you it was uncomfortable. The works of the flesh or the fruit of the Spirit? One more, we're almost there. Hang on, we're almost there. Which of the fruit of the Spirit do you need God to produce more of in you right now? Maybe as you've heard the scripture for today and you've thought through this with me for these few moments, the Holy Spirit has identified an area in your life where He wants to do some work. What do you say about that? Are you ready for that? Are you willing to submit yourself to His leadership in that way, in that area, towards that direction? Which of the fruit of the Spirit do you need God to produce more of in you right now? Well, this journey continues. We're going to keep painting the picture of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, heart, head, and hands. Next Sunday, we're going to spend one session on what does it mean to be a disciple with our head. How do we honor God with the knowledge that He has given us, with this knowing part of who we are? How is our discipleship impacted by that part of who we are as people and as His children? So I invite you to come back next Sunday as we continue this journey of simple discipleship. Let's pray. God be with us. Sometimes we're overwhelmed by these kind of truths where we feel very inadequate. We know that we have failed so much. And we need Your Holy Spirit's guidance and direction and lordship over us. And help us, Lord, to yield unto that direction and lordship. So that when we are rooted and grounded and positioned in You, Lord, You begin to produce this fruit in us. Help us in that way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us once again as we sing the closing hymn. Peace like a river.
I've got peace like a river, I've got peace.
Thank you all for being with us today. Let me remind you of a couple quick things. Next Sunday, if you have already taken one of those boxes that we're filling with gifts and school supplies for the kids in Costa Rica, please bring those back no later than next Sunday, the 25th, so that we can ship those in the days following to Costa Rica. We're also going to have a time of special prayer and commitment for each of those boxes next Sunday here as part of the worship service. So don't forget that. Also, there is a hayride next Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock. That's, again, also on the 25th of October. 4 o'clock out at Valerie and Kyle's house on Collier Road. In your First Presbyterian Weekly Update email that you receive, all the details, the address, and all the rest is located there. So if you're not on our mailing list for that, send us your email address. We'll make sure to add you. And we hope to be able to see you very, very soon. Join us next Sunday as we continue this study and continue to work to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for this day. We pray that you would guide us, help us to yield ourselves to your Holy Spirit's leadership, that he might produce this fruit in us, the fruit of the Spirit. Protect us, keep us safe, be with our schools, our teachers, our administrators, our families, our community at large, as we continue to struggle through this difficult time. We pray that you would remind us that you're always in control, and we can always trust you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.